Good morning. Happy Sabbath. I want to welcome everyone who's here, our visitors, and our online viewers, too. You know, a service like this, there's a lot of sort of what I refer to as unsung heroes. There's people behind the scenes who are putting together the music and the song teams and piano and the fellowship meals, and I just want to thank all of those people who do so much for just because they love this church. Now, it's a special Sabbath because Gary Vermette's going to join us today by profession of faith, and we're looking forward to all of that. Each week we pray for four families. This week, the four families we are praying for are Ingrid Gordon, Leslie Graham, Alfred and Gloria Greaves, and Andre and Daniel Grise. We have two fruit baskets this week. Now, each week our Sabbath school gives out a fruit basket or two to someone that we love, we want to show our love for, and this week it goes to Gary Vermette, one of the fruit baskets. And there is a second fruit basket. And the second fruit basket, oh, there, we're ready to go. And you'll be surprised by this, but the second fruit basket goes to Jesse Kong. Now, all of us here know that the Bible doesn't teach there's a ever-burning hell. That we know that's not a biblical teaching. It's a false teaching that impugns God's character. And so I've got this little thing I'm going to read to you, but know that we don't believe in a ever-burning hell. This was seen on a church sign. Whoever stole our AC units, please keep one. It is hot where you're going. Now, we don't believe that. Now we'll get into the slides. And you'll see in the bulletin as well, there's a fellowship meal today, Italian theme, so everyone's welcome to come to that. The plan is, on July 2nd, 2 weeks from now, weather permitting, we'll be at Westwood Lake, and it'll be a salad theme. So that's the plan for 2 weeks from now. Let's see the next slide. Every Wednesday night, there's a Revelation Bible study. Very good. 7 o'clock every Wednesday night here in the sanctuary. All are welcome. That's in the bulletin as well. And this is in the bulletin as well. The ABC bookmobile is coming here, and it's going to be in Nanaimo on July. Can't read that. July 6th. Now, the orders have to be placed by June 29th. All of that's in your bulletin. So you place the order online, the products will come to the church parking lot. And the next slide. BC camp meeting. We just had Island camp meeting online, a virtual camp meeting. The same for BC camp meeting. There'll be a lot more details coming out, but it's the last weekend in July, July 27th to 30th. So more information will be coming on that. Online giving, you can give your tithes and offerings here in the church, or you can do it online. And there's also a way of e-transferring now, and that's, again, on the slide. You see this each week, and I think that's in the bulletin as well. There it is, right there. So none of that works for me. As you know, I'm an old-fashioned kind of guy, so it's a check. But those of you who have skills, you can do e-transfers and all the rest of those fancy things. Now, those are all my announcements. I don't think I've forgotten any, so we'll go to the children's story next. God bless.
Hello, everyone. This is Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called Ready or Not. The memory verse is from Matthew 25, verse 13. It says, "Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." The message says people and God's family can always be ready for Jesus to come. Have you ever waited a long time for something you really wanted to happen? Have you waited for your birthday or summer vacation? Did you count the days until the excitement begins? Do you plan and dream of what it's going to be like? In our Bible story, 10 young women are waiting for a wedding to begin. They have to wait a long time. "I wish he'd hurry up and come," yawned a young woman. "We've been waiting for hours." "I'm sure it won't be much longer," encouraged another girl. "Maybe we should sit down and rest a while." 10 young women sat down and tried to get comfortable. They knew that the wedding party was supposed to pass this way. They wanted to join the group and walk with the other guests to the wedding, but none of them had expected that it would be such a long wait. 5 of the girls had thought it would be good to take along some extra oil. They really did not know when the bridegroom would come. But the other 5 had probably thought, "It won't be that long before the bridegroom comes." So they didn't put any extra oil in the containers everyone carried at night. Their lamps were full when they left home. They were sure that would be enough. So 5 of the women took extra oil, but 5 did not. It was getting late, and there was no sign of the bridegroom. The young women talked and laughed together for a long time, but one by one they nodded, yawned, and fell asleep. After a time, a call woke them up.
"Make way for the wedding party! Come and join us! Make way for the wedding party! The bridegroom comes!"
Quickly, the women reached for their lamps and stood up. "Hurry! We must add oil to our lamps or we will miss the wedding," cried one. The 5 girls who had extra oil quickly used it all to fill their lamps. But the 5 who had no extra oil just as quickly realized that they had no extra oil to keep their lamps from going out. "Give us some of your oil," they begged. "We don't want to miss the wedding." But the 5 prepared young women couldn't help them. "We wish we could give you some, but we have used all of our oil to refill our lamps. We have none left. Go quickly. Maybe you can buy oil somewhere." 5 young women in need of oil hurried off into the night. Their friends joined the wedding party and went to the wedding feast. It wasn't easy to find anyone who was willing to sell oil in the middle of the night. By the time oil was purchased and they arrived at the wedding, the door was closed and locked.
"Let us in! Please let us in," they begged, knocking loudly.
The bridegroom himself came to the door.
"I'm sorry, but I don't know you," he said. "My friends all came in with me."
He turned around and closed the door. 5 disappointed women stood outside. Like the young women waiting for the bridegroom, we cannot rely on the choices of another person. Each one has to choose to say yes to Jesus and stay ready for his coming. We stay ready by making wise choices every day, by studying the Bible and praying, by choosing every day to be best friends with him. And when Jesus comes, we will be ready.
stand as we sing?
Congregation. The works of the Lord are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them. His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endures forever. He has made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion.
To him again.
joy of with assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Sabbath. We want to thank God for this beautiful sunny day. And we also want to bring our prayers and petitions to him, for he is an ever-present help, a constant help in a time of need. And we can't emphasize how more than ever we are in need of God's intervention right now. May those who want to stand, kneel, come to the front. Join me as we put our hearts to God in this garden of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We thank you for this beautiful Sabbath morning. We thank you for the sun that's shining. Though we take it for granted, we had had a lot of very gray days, and this is a beautiful Sabbath day today. We thank you for this lovely union as we come together today to praise you, to worship you, and to bring our hearts out to you in this time of need, Lord. We want to thank you that you're a loving Father. You forgive our sins. And we ask, O Lord, to always keep us close to you, so you may guard us, protect us. And Lord, we thank you for this love that we feel as we gather today to worship you. We thank you for your friendship. We thank you for your love. And we thank you that you promised us that you would rescue us from all these troubling situations. For in your word, Lord, you said many are the troubles and trials that come to the righteous, but you will rescue us from all of them. You didn't leave any, Lord. You promised that you'd rescue us from all of them. Now we ask that you make us righteous, Lord, for we are not worthy of this, Lord. We ask that you always be near us, and especially so we bring up these four families, Lord, so you may watch over them in this coming week. So you may watch over their needs, over their prayers, over their joys, over their sorrows. We do not know what's going on in their lives, Lord, but you knew us from the time that we were in our father and mother's, in our mother's wombs. And you know them even up until today, Lord. We bring up Ingrid Gordon, Leslie Graham, Alfred and Gloria Greaves, and Andre and Daniel Grice. May you be with them in a special way, Lord. We ask for abundant blessings and mercy over their lives, Lord. May you watch over their steps, Lord. They are coming in and they are going out, Lord. We bring each and every one that's in here today. May you bless us, Lord. We thank you because you know the end from the beginning, Lord. You know exactly how each and every one of us is going to turn out. And you have already promised us, Lord, that you have good plans for us. Plans not to harm us, but to give us a future filled with hope. And we cannot wait, Lord, for your soon coming, so you may deliver us from all this, Lord. So you may establish your own government, which you mentioned, Lord, that is incorrigible. We thank you for that promise, Lord. We thank you for the love that you have given us, which gives us the hope that soon and very soon, Lord, we'll be there where there'll be no more crying, no more sorrow, no more sickness, nothing but your love and mercy. May you be with the pastor, Lord, as he brings today's word. We know it's got a special message for each and every one of us. And those watching from home, Lord, may you also bless them. May you be with them. May your fellowship keep them warm and know that they are part of us, Lord. We bring everyone today. May you open our hearts to receive the word and may you bless us today. I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Now is actually the time to return our tithes and offerings. And this week, it's for local church budget. We have plans for a set of meetings in the fall we're getting organized for, and we're looking forward to that. We also have plans for a vacation Bible school, if at all possible. So lots of things happening. We need at this time to be active in the Lord's business. There's so many people that need to know about Jesus. So the offering today is for local church budget, which helps us to fund the work here. I'll ask the ushers to come forward. Thank you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for everything you're doing in our lives. We thank you for this opportunity to return our tithes and offerings. And Lord, we ask that you bless these offerings towards the work that Nanaimo Church is planning. Be with the board and the pastor and all of those who are involved in this work. We need people to know about Jesus, Lord, and we pray all this in his precious name. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Job in chapter 29, from verses 11 to 13. When the ear heard, then it blessed me, and when the eye saw, then it approved me. I hadn't even known that it was Jeremiah today. Okay, Jeremiah 29, and I should have been looking up at the screen. Jeremiah 29, verse 11 to 13 will be our scripture reading. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. May God add a blessing to his word. Thank you.
Amen.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Good morning. We make a few mistakes here or there, but the Lord is with us. I guess it shows, it drives us to our knees to be praying to God all the time. I tell you, I probably pray more on Sabbath morning than I do any other time of the week. And as some of you know, because I'm always trying to make things better. Okay, God has a better plan. And by the way, God always has a better plan. No matter where your life is right now, no matter what the situation in life, whether it's good or bad, God has a better plan. And a plan that we can't even imagine sometimes. In fact, I could get into a long sermon here on how God's plan for me changed my whole life, but I could not even imagine where he would take me. But I'm so happy that he has began to work out his plan. I just hope I can be more willing to allow him to work in me each and every day. Now, speaking of God having a better plan, this is a picture of Gary Vermette. In just a brief moment here, we're going to hear the story of how God had a better plan for his life. And so why is it that God always has a better plan for our lives? It's because of the very nature of who he is to begin with. The Bible says that God is love. The fundamental characteristic of God, the fundamental makeup of God, is this wonderful fact found in 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, God is love. And that's why he inspired people like the prophet Jeremiah to write words of hope and comfort to a people who had turned away. If you read the context of the verses that Faith just read to you just now, these are people who had turned away from God. They found themselves in captivity because they chose to follow their own plans. Their own plans didn't work out very well. And so now God says, I have a plan for you. I have a better plan, a plan to give you a future and a hope. And so I want to put these verses up on the screen one more time so This is the foundation, as far as I'm concerned, for the whole message here today. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Remember, this is a God of love. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And what's the condition? The only condition God has in all of this is you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. You need to search for God with all your heart, and he will be there. I can testify to that myself, and many others can in this room and watching on YouTube and Facebook. And so no matter what your circumstances are this morning, God always has a better plan for your life. And we're going to hear right now how God had a better plan for Gary's life. I want you to hear the testimony. I'm going to call up Gary right now, and we're going to hear his testimony, and then I'll have a little bit more to say. So do you want to use this mic? Okay, good.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. When I started writing this testimony, I decided to title it, How God Never Gave Up On Me. It is my privilege today to explain how. I'm Gary. I was born in a small town of Sturgeon Falls, Ontario, and now reside in Ladysmith. I come from a family of five siblings, an older half-brother, two younger brothers, and two younger sisters. All of us were baptized as babies in a Catholic church. At kindergarten school age, I had my first communion and started going to church on Sundays. As I recall, my parents were not much of churchgoers themselves. As I got a bit older, I was left on my own to walk to church just a few blocks away from where we lived. Later on, it was my responsibility to lead my younger siblings to church. This lasted till the age of 10, after which I would slowly start to leave this task to my slightly younger sister. As I grew up in my preteen years, I started skipping church more and more often, and my parents no longer forced me to attend. It began very gradual, and I started not to think about God so much anymore. It wasn't really intentional, and it's not that I hated to go to church. It was just a very gradual fading of God's presence in my life, and I can't explain why. Eventually, I began feeling indifferent about both God and church. Growing up, we attended school and were taught by Catholic brothers and nuns. In those early years, my home life wasn't that great because my parents drank a lot, and there was lots of arguing between them most times. Talk and instructions about God's word was non-existent in our home. To make matters worse, I was hanging out with a gang of friends who were always getting me into trouble. This caused my parents a lot of stress, to say the least. My associations with these friends caused me to stay out late at night, joining them in less than desirable activities and getting into all kinds of mischiefs. This went on for a few years, and I started getting rebellious towards my parents, superiors at school, and even local authorities. I argued a lot with my parents and became disobedient, confrontational, insolent, and very disrespectful. I was definitely breaking God's fifth commandment about honoring my mother and father, but sadly by that time, I had forgotten most of the Ten Commandments. I regret that I had become such a burden to my parents with all the misery and hardship I caused them. They died at a very young age, and I hope to tell them that in heaven one day. And right now, I need to go off my intended script here for a moment because I feel it's an important message to send out to parents out there who might be listening, and I'll explain why a bit later. There was something that happened in my childhood that remained as a scar for the rest of my life. There was this incident one time when my mom came back home drunk. And I found out there was something that I should have done, but I didn't. I don't remember what. She started yelling and cursing at me for this, and next thing you know, I was on the stairs leading upstairs, cowering down into this little ball. My mom, in her anger, kept on cursing and hitting me with what I don't remember. She was so angry and wouldn't stop. My father came in through the front door, saw my mom repeatedly hitting me while I was crying for her to stop. My dad rushed upstairs and grabbed my mom's hand to stop her from striking me. My mom, in her anger, was yelling, "I hate that one. I hate him." Meaning me for my other siblings. That was more painful to bear than the beating I was being given. My dad gently consoled me and told me to go up to my room. Then I would hear them yelling and arguing to each other about what just happened. Why I bring this up is I would go on remembering those painful words for most of my life. They stung so bad and affected me for a very long time. Where was God, I wondered later, when I needed his protection? But I realized he was there because he sent my dad to protect me in that moment. Now, I'm not blaming my parents for all the wrong deeds I did in my life. There comes a time as a mature person where we make our own choices and have to bear the consequences without blaming others for it. I also realized that my mother did not mean those words, that she hated me. She was under the influence of alcohol and her weakness. Satan attacked her while she was vulnerable and made her do things that was not natural to her. I knew deep down she loved me and would, years later, to tell me she would tell me this. I bring this up because it is important for parents to know that a few ugly, unintentional, angry words or deeds can have an effect on a person that will scar them for a good portion of their life. I forgave my mom for her anger and her words towards me, and hold no malice towards my parents, whose judgments were fueled by evils of alcohol, and Satan was there to take advantage of their weakness. Moving into my teenage years, things were not improving at all. I was caught by the police, charged with mischief, breaking and entering, and other minor thefts, which resulted in being sent to reform school a couple of times. These reform schools were disciplinary institutions for younger, unruly kids in need of correction, discipline, and rehabilitation, and usually deserved to be there. The second time I was sent there at age 14, I kept getting disciplined for disobeying the rules and being defiant and fighting. This would be punishable by losing certain privileges such as game playing, sports and recreational activities, and even rations of 2 cigarettes per day. I did not smoke at the time, so I treated them to the boys for favors. During my stay at reform school, I sometimes reflected back on my life and resolved that when I returned home, I would start behaving correctly, show more respect towards my parents, and keep out of trouble. My mom and dad came to visit me a couple of times during my stay, and those were wonderful moments. I remember my mom tearing up when she saw me and hugged me quite tenderly. I felt in that moment my mother's overwhelming love for me. I did not want to let her go. It had been so long since I got a hug like that. These were pleasant visits, which I cherished a lot, and I vowed to them that when I got back home, I was going to be a better son and behave much better. That pleased them, and they said they could hardly wait for me to make a new start. I finally served my time at reform school and went back home just in time for me to start junior high school. I think I lasted for 3 to 4 months in high school before I started getting restless and bored. The drinking and arguing between my parents still continued. I just wanted to get away from all the turmoil. I started missing homework, skipping school, and began to hang out with my friends, my old friends again. I would often get expelled from classes for days on end. I fell behind so much in my homework assignments that eventually I could not keep up any longer. I got so hopelessly discouraged that I finally quit, despite my parents' attempt to encourage me from doing so. By then, I was learning to be independent, self-reliant, and nothing they could say would change my mind. The strife between us was getting worse, and I dishonored my parents once again. At age 15, I left home, and I got a job as a dispatcher at a taxi stand, working the night shift and bootlegging liquor for the owner. This bootlegging of alcohol was illegal, and if I got caught, I was afraid I would go to jail. But having made the decision to move out from home, I now had to survive on my own. I was determined not to go back home. This lasted for about a year, and I was back in front of a judge, facing various charges, such as breaking and entering, destroying public property, and vagrancy. By then, I was still young enough to avoid adult jail time, but still faced juvenile detention, which was a much tougher institution than reform school. However, the judge was lenient on me and gave me a choice of either getting a full-time decent job, subject to his approval, or joining the Canadian Forces. He gave me a couple of weeks to decide. I talked it over with my parents and opted for a military career and joined the Navy, which was the best thing that happened to me in quite a long time. I was now able to sustain myself with my own income and make a decent living as long as I wanted if I chose to remain in the Navy. I learned the trade of naval electronics and traveled all around the world, making lots of friends, and was very happy with the way my career was working out. A couple of years after joining, I met a Christian girl named Linda. We fell in love just as she was finishing high school. A bit over a year later, we were married and embarked on a new life together. Within a year, we had started a family and had two wonderful kids, a girl named Tammy, and 2 years later, a boy named Brent. Being a military dad, my job demanded strict discipline, and unfortunately, I carried that over into my private life. This resulted in being overly strict, making errors in judgment, and messed up my relationship with my kids. However, later on, thanks be to God, my faults and shortcomings as a dad would be forgiven, and we would reconcile and get along much better. During those years, my wife and I did not attend church, pray together, or even discuss religion. Even though we both believed in God, we did not conduct our lives in a good Christian manner. Sadly, we got our kids baptized as infants because that's what was expected of us as Catholics. We hardly taught them anything about God, and they grew up ignorant of Jesus and the Bible. As supposedly Christian parents, we had failed in that respect. Both our kids grew up as non-believers and still are to this day. However, this still does not diminish the love parents have for their children. I pray every day that God will manifest his presence in them in some fashion that eventually will draw them to Christ. I so want them in heaven with us at Jesus' second coming, and I still have great hope that my prayers will be answered. Our kids will eventually grow into adulthood and get married themselves. We had one grandson through our daughter Tammy. My son and his wife would experience divorce early in their marriage. Back in my own home life, things seemed to cruise along well, with steady promotions throughout my career, but unfortunately still remained separated from God and still under Satan's influence, I believe. But God had other plans for me. So fast forward to 2013, at age 65, retired from the Navy, I was still indifferent to God and indulging in my own selfish desires. I was smoking and drinking socially at the time. I finally stopped smoking and got into running to pursue a healthier lifestyle. God gave me the gift of being able to run fast, so I started running races often. One day, while bike training in Nanaimo, for a long-distance triathlon, a sport that involves swimming, biking, and running in that order. There, I met Steve, who was also training for a triathlon. I learned that he was a pastor who was moving to Ladysmith to plant a new church. We became friends, but I gave no thought to church, as that was not even on my radar at the time. I was training and focusing for an Ironman race in Arizona, and I traveled there with my wife 2 to 3 weeks ahead of the actual event in order to acclimatize to the much hotter climate in that location. One day, as I was practicing my swimming at a small remote lake, while my wife watched me from the beach, she met a young lady named Debbie, whose daughter Amy was also in the lake training. After my swim practice, I met the mom and my wife, and I started chatting with her. We learned that she and her husband, John, both devout Christians, were part of a race, the race organizations coordinating the bike section of the race. They were also involved in a triathlon sports ministry, FAC, which was the acronym for Fellowship of Christian Athletes. During our conversations, she informed me that they were having a worship event the evening before the big race. There would be prayers, music, worship songs, and testimonies from different athletes on how God came into their lives. She invited Linda and I to attend if that was something that would be of interest to us. This is where things started to take a turn for me in my life. Remember earlier, I said that God had other plans for me. This also included pulling me away from Satan's hold on me. A week before my big race, I started thinking about God every night when I went to bed. I just could not get him out of my mind. I had not given him any thought for so many years. Why now? What was happening? Why was he constantly in my thoughts? I asked myself. I could not sleep properly as God was constantly on my mind. Night after night, until race day, I was deep in thought about God and finally decided to pray to him. I told him he was on my mind quite a bit lately, which he knew, of course. I asked him, despite my long absence of him in my life, if it was too late to have a relationship with him again. I did not readily get an answer to this, but sensed that God still loved and wanted me with him. But why, I asked, because I certainly did not deserve his attention. I did not tell my wife about these nightly encounters with God in my thoughts. I was not sure what was going on in my heart, but believed it was opening up to fill that empty gap within, to let God's Holy Spirit in. The more I thought about it, the more I became convicted that I wanted to pursue a lasting relationship with him. 2 days before the race, I told my wife that I wanted to attend the worship event that we had been invited to and asked if she wanted to join me. I did not tell my wife of my reasons for doing so, as I did not think she would understand what I was going through at the time. She politely declined to come with me, so I went on my own. It turned out to be a wonderful event, to say the least. The worship singing was uplifting, and the testimonies were unique, sincere, and thought-provoking. After this event, I became more convinced that I really wanted God back into my life to experience the joy that some of these other athletes were having. The night before my race, I did a lot of soul searching, and I asked God to forgive all my sins and my indifference to him for the past 50 years of my life. Without spoken words, I again sensed his forgiveness and believe I slept more peacefully that night than I had all week. Next day, I completed my race and thanked God for keeping me through it all. Keeping me safe through it all. I contacted my new friends, Deb and John, by email a few days later before going back home. I told them what had transpired between God and I during the week, that I was letting God back into my life after so many years, and thanked them so much for the invite that initiated all this. They were thrilled, to say the least, and offered me some guidance on how to proceed in my new journey. They told me that once I got home, I should get connected with a Bible-based Christian church for accountability and to have fellowship with other believers. They also urged me to start reading God's Word and to pursue Bible lessons for a more thorough understanding of scriptures. I concurred, and we agreed to keep in touch by email on my progress. I was determined to see all this through, but where to start? First, I told my wife of my desires to start going to church again, that I felt a need to have God in my life. She was happy for me and very encouraging. She decided she would start going to church also, which pleased me because I wanted us united together as a Christian couple. First, I had to find a Christian church to join. My wife decided she would return to Catholic Church, which she attended in her youth, was familiar with, and was located just a few minutes from our home. I did not favor this for myself, however, and immediately thought about Steve, the pastor friend that I had met earlier, and called him. We talked at great length, and I told him of my experience in Arizona and wanted to start attending church. He said, great. He was having his first church service soon and invited me to attend his church, which he named the Rock Christian Fellowship Church in Ladysmith. He told me he was looking for more people to join this small beginning congregation. And so began my walk with God, learning from my pastor, the Bible, and having fellowship with a small group of believers that was growing in numbers every week. 2 years later, I was to go back to the roots of my renewed faith and do another triathlon in Arizona again. My wife did not join me on this one, and we arranged for her sister to visit and keep her company in my absence. I called my friends in Arizona to inform them, and the subject of baptism came up. If I was willing, they could help arrange for me to be baptized before the race event, and I thought that was a fantastic idea. This time, I would choose to be baptized willingly as an adult by immersion. We had arranged for me to be baptized in the river that I would be swimming in for my race. It only seemed fitting, seeing that this location was the beginning of my renewed faith. This baptism would be for me a rebirth in Christ through the Holy Spirit. It was a very solemn but happy occasion for me, with my friends looking on from shore. But I missed my wife not being there for this very special occasion. After the baptism, I went on to complete my race in a good time for my age group and gave all the glory to God for my success. I would go on learning God's word at my church for a number of years until Pastor Steve had to move to Vancouver to accommodate his wife's flourishing career. This was a downward turn for the church. We were left without much leadership and a dwindling congregation. It just seemed like my learning was winding down to a slow grind. I was starting to lose the zeal and enthusiasm that I had when I first started my walk with God. It reminds me of a verse that I have recently read in Revelation chapter 2, verse 4, that Jesus was giving to the church of Ephesus. Quote, "But there is something I hold against you. You don't have as much love as you had at first," unquote. And I definitely wanted that enthusiasm and love for God's word again. So I started to do some research online for resources that would help me. There was so much online that I felt overwhelmed by the amount of information that was available to me. What to believe, I asked. This was, after all, the internet, where we just can't take everything we read for granted. Meanwhile, my wife Linda still attended Catholic Church, but that was her choice, and I accepted that. I just wished we could both be in sync in all our spiritual learning. My wife loves and is faithful to God, and I am convinced that she will also be in God's kingdom with me one day, as well as many others from other faiths. In John 10, verse 16, Jesus declares, "I have other sheep that do not belong to this sheepfold. I must bring them in too. They also will listen to my voice, and then there will be one flock and one shepherd." That Bible verse is most encouraging to me. One day, I was reading the first few chapters in the book of Revelations about God's message to the seven churches. But in later chapters, I could not for the life of me understand what I was reading. With dragons, beasts with many heads and horns and trumpets, and the harlot, what did this all mean? I was thinking literally of all these things, and it made very little sense to me, and frankly, it was kind of scary. However, I learned through further studies that in Revelations there was a lot of symbolism. I continued to study to understand the meaning behind it all. My persistence led me to a website of Advent World Radio and a video series on YouTube called Unlocking Bible Prophecies, hosted by AWR Vice President Cami Utman. My wife and I both watched those videos with keen interest. The theme for those videos was, if it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it is not in the Bible, it's not for me. Everything in those videos was backed up by scripture, which I double-checked in my Bible and found true. These videos also revealed to me new truths and many false teachings during the time of the Roman papacy and the persecutions of millions of Christians. Later on, I would watch another series, Salvation in Symbols and Signs, which this church just started a few weeks ago. These videos sure has made it easy for me to understand this important book of Revelations. In my research, I also came across links to Ellen White, one of God's messengers, whose teachings are quite relevant for our times. The first of her books that I read and listened by audio was Desire of Ages, which explains the whole life of Jesus and his ministry in minute details. Listening to this audiobook revealed to me Jesus' ministry in quite a new light, explaining it in more details and giving me more thorough understanding and insight. Another of her books, The Great Controversy, has certainly opened my eyes to the persecution of the Dark Ages. I am simply amazed by Ellen White's writing skills, despite only 3 years of formal education because of her early childhood illnesses. I was to learn that she has become one, if not the most prolific, Christian female writers of all times. The eloquence of her words and the message she conveys could only be divinely inspired by God Himself. Truly, she is God's prophetess for our church. She does not add or take away from the Bible, but rather explains it and amplifies Scripture to a level frequently backing up her statements through Bible verses. After finishing the Unlocking Bible Prophecy series, I decided to search online for Seventh-day Adventist churches that I could connect with for more learning in person. I felt in my heart this church was the one to continue my journey of faith with. I Googled Adventist churches near me and came upon this church here in Nanaimo. I contacted Pastor Rudd and inquired about attending this church. He told me anyone could attend the church on Sabbath days, but suggested that if eventually I wanted to join as a member, that we could study together on Zoom because of COVID at the time. I agreed wholeheartedly, and a couple of days later, he personally came to my home and introduced himself. He gave me an envelope full of amazing fact study guides. I could study these during the week and follow up with weekly Zoom meetings with him to discuss the contents of the lessons and ask any questions I wanted. I found the lessons very well laid out, easy to understand, and quite enjoyed our weekly study sessions together. Approximately 6 months later, we would go on to study a second set of booklets, which we completed a few weeks ago. Overall, we studied together a little over a year. While studying, I began attending this church, sometimes virtually on YouTube, or in person, depending on what COVID protocols dictated at the time. On completion of all my lessons, I expressed my desire to Pastor Rudd that I would like to become a permanent member of this church. Since I was sufficiently satisfied with my previous baptism, we talked, and he suggested that I could join by profession of faith and giving a testimony. I was a bit hesitant about broadcasting my testimony on social media, some of which I am not fond of due to its inherent security risks and other concerns. But Pastor Rudd persuaded me that these testimonies will sometimes stir up the hearts of people into accepting God in their own lives, and so I agreed. In closing, to be honest, I have gained more understanding about God's Word this past year and a half through Seventh-day Adventist teachings than I have in my whole previous 12 years combined since I came back to God. I believe studying the Bible is a lifelong learning experience, and I truly have a desire and a passion now for continuous learning. I know in my heart that this church, God's Remnant Church, is the one that I should belong to. I was lost for 50 long years, and God brought me back to Him. Like all His children, I believe I have some value to Him. I am surrendered to Him now and believe He has yet more plans for me, which I know not of yet, but I intend on being forever faithful to Him and to never get lost again, so I can see those plans come to fruition. God wants as many of His children as possible to join in Him in His kingdom. Like Christ's apostles, I believe that is also our mission, to try and bring as many as we can to Jesus through spreading of the gospel of the three angels' message, and we will be blessed for it. Thank you, Pastor Rudd, for all the wise instructions and understanding you gave me. You have been so patient with all my questions, and I appreciate all the time you have devoted to my learning. And thank you all for welcoming me cheerfully amongst you as a visitor this past year. I yearn now to be a permanent part of your church family. Thanks again, and may God pour His blessings on you all.
Thanks, Gary. Just hang on for a second here. So, having heard Gary's testimony and his desire to become a member of this church, is there a motion now to receive Gary Vermette into membership of the 907th Adventist Second Most Second? All those in favor, please raise your hands. Okay, this is your local church family here now. A small part of the 22 million that we have around the world right now, okay? You'll get to meet all 22 million one day, too, okay? Okay, so I've got a few more things yet to say, another couple of minutes, but before I do, I just want all these things that Gary said to kind of sink in and kind of meditate on these things. And so I thought, what better way than to bring the Diorek family up? So Diorek family, please come up. And they're going to sing a song that they sing at home all the time. It's called God Will Take Care of You, okay? So I think Raz is going to play the piano. And now Raz is 9 years old, okay? And he's quite a piano player for nine. And Gabby's already done it, actually. He's going to rig him up with a microphone here so that he can sing. So this is a new thing that I haven't heard Raz do yet. He's going to sing and play at the same time. Okay, and the family's going to come up here, take a microphone, folks. So I'll just ask you to just have a seat with Linda for a few minutes. I'm going to bring you back up in a few minutes, okay? Okay. So, you can stand down here if you'd like, or you can, and the words will be up on the screen, okay? So, all the kids have microphones? Okay, kids, so sing nice and loud, okay? Okay, God will take care of you, okay? Whenever you're ready, Raz.
God will take care of you. God will take care of you. God will take care of you.
Thanks very much. Hasn't it been an inspiring morning this morning? Amen? Okay, I just have just a couple things I want to say. The very first words of Gary's testimony this morning are these. He says, when writing this testimony, I decided to tell it the story of how God never gave up on me. So keep that in mind. The truth is that God never gives up on any of us. We can give up on him, and many of us do, but he never gives up on us. In fact, that's the reason why the second coming of Christ hasn't taken place yet. You know, people sometimes ridicule me. Pastor, you talk about the second coming of Christ. Well, where has he been? Well, this is an answer. 2 Peter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise. That's the promise of coming back for us, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He wants to save everyone that he can. So we heard the story, and I'll just run through it really quickly. We heard the story of how Gary drifted away from the picture of God that he was presented as a young child, and then he got himself into trouble, and he had to end up, went to reform school, and he got himself into trouble again. He ended up this time joining the Navy, and during those years, he really didn't think very much about God, but then he finally retires, and he decides to take up running and swimming and cycling, otherwise known as the triathlon. He finds that he was very good at that, so he was taking that up and also to become healthier. And all this time, God is waiting patiently for Gary, just as he's waiting patiently for all of us. And finally, Gary is invited to a worship service in Arizona. The Holy Spirit convicted him, and he began searching. Remember, he said, I couldn't sleep at night. God was on my mind night after night after night. Remember what Jeremiah 29 says, if you seek for God, if you search for him with all your heart. And later he was baptized. But he felt the need to know God better. He didn't want to lose his first love. You heard him repeat from the verse to the church of Ephesus there. And so now God has opened up a new door for Gary, an exciting door which leads into the Seventh-day Adventist Church, God's remnant church. Gary told us this morning that he said, I have gained more understanding about God's word this past year and a half through the Seventh-day Adventist teachings than I have in my previous 12 years combined since I came back to God. I can tell you that I experienced that same explosion of knowledge from God when I first became an Adventist 30 years ago. I was hungry, just as hungry as Gary was. I hope you're hungry out there today. If you don't have an experience with God yet, I hope that hunger is burning within you right now, because he has the answer to this. As I say, I experienced the same thing that Gary's experienced, and God will do the very same for all of you if you give him a chance. I want you to hear these words from Jesus now. These words became very important to me 30 years ago when I first started to attend the Adventist church. These are the words from Jesus in John 7, verses 16 and verse 17. Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his who sent me. And then he says these words, if anyone wills to do his will, that's the condition. If anyone is willing to follow God, if anyone is willing to listen to God, if anyone is willing to follow what you have right now, then he shall know concerning the doctrine whether it is from God or whether I just speak on my own authority. If you want to know the truth of God's word, as you look around the world, as you go on the internet, as you go from church to church, which is what I did when I was younger, if you're willing to follow God's word, he will lead you to the truth, and you will know the difference between truth and error. So if we're willing to follow the will of God for our lives, he'll reveal this truth to us, and we'll know that it comes from him. So all of this comes down to one question. Are we willing to seek after God with all our heart? Are we willing to listen to his voice this morning? Are we willing to follow him this morning? And these are the last verses I want to give you here. They're from Isaiah, Isaiah 55. It's a few verses here, but they're very powerful. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near, and he's near to every one of you here today. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord. He will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. This is the God of love that we're talking about. It says, and then he says this, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, says God. Nor are my ways, are your ways my ways, says the Lord. You see, God always has a better plan. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and they do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. It shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. And then these beautiful words, for you shall go out with joy. I've had joy for the last 30 years now because of this message. And be led out with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you. And all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. And this is only going to get better and better, by the way. And then it says, instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress tree. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. It shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. You'll have a name that will never be cut off. So we just sang a song, or the kids just sang a song here called God Will Take Care of You. I can tell you that God will take care of you. He's taken care of me now for the last 30 years, and he'll take care of you too, Gary and Linda, for the rest of your lives. He'll keep his promise if we're willing to give him a chance. And so I want to end this by just saying this. Welcome to the family, Gary. And I want to invite you and Linda now to come up to the front here. And we've got a few things for you here. We've got a little presentation of some gifts. Come on up and turn around so everybody can see you on camera as well as everybody here. So Barb has some things. Can you carry both at the same time, Barb? Okay, she'll do one at a time. Yeah, you'll get the heavy bag, Gary. There's a lot of good reading material, a lot of good books in there, okay? Remember, you want to keep on learning. You'll be reading that for a while, okay? There's a great book in there by Mark Finley, by the way, which every new believer really loves. And Linda gets the flowers. Okay. And now I want to just invite the elders to come forward now. We're going to pray for Gary and Linda, and also for their children and their grandchildren, who I know, as you heard from Gary's message here, they're both praying for their kids and their grandkids as well. So please come forward and lay hands on these good folks. I better get out of the camera. Michael's coming. And I'm just going to have a prayer. Okay. You know, it's one of the things I want to tell everybody, because this is on my mind. It's not part of the sermon. But Linda here is I guess you could almost call her a pro golfer. She has 24 holes in one. Has anybody here hit a hole in one in your life? No? I played golf a little bit when I was younger, but I never got a hole in one. She's had 24 of them, okay? But I can tell you, the life that you're now about to embark on is far, far greater than getting a hole in one, okay? Okay, imagine what the golf courses are going to be like on the new earth one day. Okay, let's pray for you now. Loving Father in heaven, Lord, we just lift up this couple to you now, Lord. First of all, Lord, we want to ask you to please bless Gary. And Lord, he's been searching for you these last 12 years, Lord, and you've come through for him, Lord, and now he's learning and growing with each passing day. We pray that will continue. We pray for Linda, his wife, Lord, to be by his side, Lord, that you will lead both of these two side by side, Lord, into your kingdom. And Lord, we pray for their daughter, Tammy, their son, Brent, the grandchildren, Lord, we pray for them. I know, and also Gary's sister, Christine, back in Ontario, Lord, we pray for the family, and I'm sure there's more in the family that I don't even know about, but you know each one, Lord, so we pray for them. We ask you to please bless them, please draw them to you the way you've drawn Gary, Lord, and may the whole family be united one day as they see you coming in the clouds of glory to pick up your children and take us home, Lord. So we thank you for them. We ask that you would fill them with your spirit now, Lord. And may you give Gary the gifts that he needs to reach out to others and to carry out his ministry in this church. And Lord, may you lead both of them side by side for the rest of their lives. And may we all be together on that great day when you come back for us, Father, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Okay, we're going to sing now. Our closing song. I just want to be, as Mads is coming up, as the singers are coming up, I just want to say, yeah, you may as well stay up here if you want to. You can sing. Everybody can watch you on camera. So I'm not a good singer, so if you guys can sing, you'll drown me out, okay? So that's part of it. And so I just want to say for all those watching at home right now that committing your life to the Lord will be the best decision you ever make in your life. It was the best decision I ever made, and it will be the best that you make as well. So we're going to invite everyone now to stand as we sing our closing song called All the Way. And think of the words of this song and how they pertain to the lives of these two and also to all of us.
Raise my soul through endless.
So until we meet again, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with every one of you. Amen.
Peace be with you.